April is the cruelest month. Thus begins T.S. Eliot's poem, The Wasteland. So it would seem, we have gathered here on the 10th anniversary of the shootings at Columbine High School, shootings that initially shocked our nation. This season of the year seems to spawn violence as surely as it spawns tornadoes and floods. In the past 10 years, we've discovered that there is no place exempt from this violence. We have witnessed it in schools and churches, in nursing homes and on college campuses, in public spaces like sidewalks and parking lots, in the private sanctuaries of families' living rooms and children's bedrooms, in places where ordinary people live ordinary lives. And so tonight we have come to remember, to light candles, to hold hands, to listen to music, to find comfort. And in spite of all that, we are sad. We are saddened by lives cut short. We are saddened by lives shattered. We are saddened by innocence betrayed. We are saddened by our own impotence to stop the violence. Sadness saps our spirits, and unabated, it gives way to despair. And so we gather, hoping that our prayers and our vigils and our candles will somehow lighten the heaviness of our hearts. I will show you fear in a handful of dust, wrote T.S. Eliot a few lines later. In the last 10 years, we have become more fearful. Police guard the entrance to school buildings. We've grown accustomed to metal detectors and monitors. The sales of guns and ammunition have increased. A child's prank phone call can throw a whole school into lockdown, and a high school student's threatening note can empty the building of students. We have to take these things seriously, the administration says in a press release, and none of us need an explanation. We all understand it happened in Columbine, it happened in Red Lake, it happened in West Nickel, Pennsylvania, it happened in Arkansas, and it could happen here. The very thought strikes fear in our hearts. And so we build up security. We get more guards. We put in more metal detectors. We make more safety plans. We buy more guns. We increase the freedom to carry concealed weapons. We have more concealed weapons. And fear keeps us moving in a circle. We don't know how to disrupt the cycle. Fear begets violence, begets fear, begets more violence. Is there any hope? Sadness, fear. And yet there is something else that accompanies our grief. Something else that lurks in the shadows. Something else with which many of us are not particularly comfortable. Something else which I believe can be the source of hope. Anger. That's right, I said it, anger. It's an emotion that a lot of us, particularly in the Midwest, would rather avoid. It's a difficult emotion to manage. It's a hard emotion to channel. It can get out of control and it can be misdirected. But when I have worked with the victims of abuse and the victims of violence and the victims of injustice, I have found that hope is often born on the rocky slopes of anger. Anger produces energy, the kind of energy that's required to break the grip that fear has on us. Anger produces energy, the kind of energy that can get us moving in spite of sadness. My sister lives in Colorado, not too far from Columbine High School. Not long after the shootings, there was a memorial to the students who died someone erected 14 crosses. People exploded with anger. How dare whoever put that memorial together include Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold among the victims? Didn't they deserve to die? There were editorials in the paper and lots of conversation in lines at the grocery store and at the coffee shop. Our anger cannot be aimed at the perpetrators of violence. Eric and Dylan are victims too. They are victims of a society that tolerates violence as the answer to conflict. They are victims of a society in which violence has become an anesthetic for personal angst. They are victims of a society that isolates adolescents and fails in reaching out to troubled adults. They are victims of a society with what I call a cultural addiction to violence. That's where our anger needs to be directed. Not toward individual perpetrators of violence, and not toward the NRA and others who defend the right to carry guns, but toward our culture's fundamental addiction to violence. And in dealing with addictions, the very first step is breaking the silence. That's why tonight is so important. It's a good thing to light candles. It's a good thing to ring the bell. It's a good thing to name names. And it's a good thing to hold hands and comfort each other. But I say it is vastly more important for our children and for our children's children that we break the silence and we say out loud, this must stop. These killings in schools and churches, in nursing homes and on college campuses, in public spaces and in private sanctuaries are not isolated events. They are all related because they are all symptoms of something fundamentally wrong in our society. And what is wrong is this. We have come to tolerate violence as an acceptable part of our life. We live in a society that can listen to the evening news and then go on with the dinner party because we have become so accustomed to this. This gathering in Duluth tonight is a breaking of silence. Your presence here helps break the silence. We can be angry at this senseless loss of life. We can be angry at our culture's tolerance for violence. We can be angry at our society's use for violence as an anesthetic against pain and frustration and isolation. We can be angry even about our own impotence. And it's out of that anger that we will find energy. Energy for change, energy to challenge, energy to dream of a time when there will not need to be gatherings like tonight. A few verses later in The Wasteland, Eliot wrote, "My cousin took me out on a sled, and I was frightened. He said, 'Marie, Marie, hold on tight,' and down we went. In the mountains, you feel free. On the rocky slopes of anger, hope is often born. It's like that small flower that grows in the cracks and the crevices and the rocky soil of the mountains in Colorado. It is a fragile but beautiful flower. It is persistent. In the Colorado law books of 1899, when it was declared the state's national flower, it was also written that all citizens have the duty to protect it from needless destruction and waste. And the name of the flower is the Columbine. Amen."